what I'm talking about.
Don't make us change careers.
Sway in the Morning, Shade 405. Ladies and gentlemen, sometimes have to be, you got to appreciate the days that you wake up.
Amen.
You able to live in your passion.
Amen.
And you even appreciate it more when you can share it with people you consider friends.
Amen.
Good people, man. Good in the heart. Good in how they represent themselves across the globe, across the world. Very talented individuals that you got to give their flowers to while they're here, Heather B.
Family.
With that said, that's family, man. We got the five-time NBA All-Star, All-NBA First Team, three-time All-NBA Second, All-NBA Third Team, NBA Rookie of the Year, NBA Rebounding Leader, number four, retired Sacramento King. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Basketball, USA, McDonald's All-American MVP, and the list goes on and on and on and on. You can watch him on TV as one of the best NBA commentators in the game today.
Hey.
Good friend of mine, the one and only, the legendary, Mr. Chris Webber!
Yeah. That's the way to wake up. You make me feel good about myself.
Yes,
what's up, mama? I made it.
Yes, man. Yes, man. And what you may not know about him, hip-hop producer,
yes.
Hip-hop MC,
yes.
Too Much Drama, All I Got. This man been spitting bars since the 90s,
yep.
And he's here with us today. Chris Webber, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
Come on, man. Chris, how you been, man?
Man, I'm doing good, man. It's such an honor to be here
come
with you
on,
and Heather B, man. This is great, man. I've known you for a long time,
man.
And so when I'm listening to both of you, I get that energy in the morning and everything. So I'm just honored to be here, man. God is good, man.
Wow, man. Amen. He's a citizen. Chris is a citizen.
That's right,
morning, baby.
That's
it is,
right,
man.
That's right.
Now, last time that we hung out,
mm-hmm.
I don't know if you remember this, but I tell this story and people don't believe me. I said one time I came to Atlanta. And we was doing some footage on African artifacts and collections that Chris Webber has.
Mm-hmm.
And I was at his house. And Chris says, Sway, my house is your house. Take your shoes off. Do what you want to do. Big ass kitchen. I almost got lost in the refrigerator. You know.
You went in the refrigerator?
Hell yeah. That's how I went in the refrigerator. I was trying to get into the rooms that they didn't say we could go to. You know, and he showed me this amazing collection of African-American artifacts he had been collecting since the early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
And I already knew the brother was multi-layered. I knew he had a lot of depth to him. I knew I could learn a lot from him. And then I went down to the water because this particular home, I don't know how many he has now, but one of the things I admired about him, I believe you said you had 100 acres?
Yeah.
He said he had 100 acres. I said, this man has property.
Mm-hmm.
He has land. And he said, we could go ride dune buggies or whatever and go hunting, and we could go fishing. I said, fishing?
And that got you. Yeah, I remember. You ain't even talked to me no more. You just went out there and went fishing.
I went fishing. And I was bullshitting like I was on his dock. And I saw he had rods and reels on the dock. They were old. They were to my caliber. But I picked them up.
Wow.
Not for a professional fisherman like yourself.
Yeah, not like what an angler would normally do. But I picked it up and worked with the prehistoric apparatus he had. And I was demonstrating in front of the MTV cameras because I was going to create a fishing show.
Yeah.
And I'm talking. I'm like, welcome to whatever I call it, the show. I'm here at Chris Webber's house. You know, he's an adamant fisherman, blah, blah. And I'm dropping a lure there. And as I'm talking, I said, we're going to take it to break. Ooh. And I hooked a bass.
Yo.
And really, yeah. You remember this?
Yeah, I remember that. No, yeah. Yeah, no, that's real. That's real. I go fishing, man. I try to go fishing to keep that peace maybe once a week. My nephew, Jordan, he goes fishing probably every other day in the summer, man. It's a blessing. I live in a town. It's like one stoplight, you know what
uh-huh.
I mean? And it's cool, the peace, the quiet, man, all that. I love it, man.
Man, I love it.
I didn't think you remember that. Yeah, yeah,
man,
you caught it. Yeah, right as you was going to break on time. So I got the fish train, man. That's all we do.
Oh, that what it was?
Help you out, man.
I thought I had to fish food, but if that's how you saw it, Chris, we'll take it like that. But that was an amazing experience, and I'll never forget. That was one of my favorite times I ever had.
Thank
like
you,
because I feel like I'm talking to the homie
mm-hmm.
through my job, which really did, and then that makes it doesn't become work anymore.
Yeah, no, man, not at all.
Proud of you, man. I love watching when you commentate on NBA TV. I love how you transition. I love how you never keep yourself in a box.
Thank you.
You don't do one thing, man. Where did you develop that notion?
Watching, you know, people like yourself, other people. You know, when you see someone that looks like you do something, you think you can do it. That's why I go to schools and tell kids, you know, look at me. Whatever you think I could do, you could do 10 times more than that. And so you know how it is. As a man, you want to make sure that you always have opportunities. So when I first started doing commentating, no one believed in me. And then when I first started doing games, no one believed in me. And so it came a thing like, let's prove it. What dreams do you have? What do you want to achieve? How can you empower yourself? How can you hire some other people and move forward? So I just try to work hard, keep shout out to Marv Albert, Dick Stockton, the guys that taught me how to commentate and had some really good mentors. And so I just try to keep it moving and stay positive, man.
Man, okay, I was going to ask you who helped mentor you because you're pretty damn good, bro. You're smooth. You're right in the pocket in terms of – and then your chemistry is so great. What about the other players? Because I know when players start commentating, a lot of the professional commentators were like, oh, man, here we go.
Yeah.
That's like rappers trying to act.
Yeah, you know. They're taking our jobs.
Yeah, they're taking our jobs, man. But you, but what about other players? Who did anybody feel like threatened or was it competitive in that?
No, not really. You know, Reggie Miller – you know, he showed me how to take notes.
Okay.
You know, I knew how to take notes for other things, but he was like, no, this is how you do it for here. This is how you come to the game. So, and with that, I'm very humble. I'm very thankful that Ahmad Rashad, you know, a football player and then a basketball player, but a football player and then a TV guy, he helped me out. So, no, it wasn't any competition amongst the players. You know, I think everybody's confident enough to know if they got their job already, they're pretty safe in it, and they didn't want me to embarrass them. And it's like, hey, let us build you up. So I can only thank the older heads that really helped me get into this.
Okay. I mean, we're here to talk about the movie you're in or that you're involved with, right, Uncle Drew? Okay.
Yeah.
But before we get to that,
hold on, man. Let's keep talking, man. We got time.
We're going to come to that. Can you talk about the concept of the super team? And where did it first begin? Because as you know, I am from Oakland.
Yeah.
And I
the town.
and you know we love you in Oakland.
Yeah.
Okay.
I love Oakland.
We've shown you a lot of love over the years.
Yeah.
And people discredit these victories, these championships sometimes. They undermine them because they said it's not fair. And I always argue that the Warriors weren't a super team. It was just a great team put together that plays with great chemistry that have evolved into what you perceive as a super team. Klay Thompson and all these Green and all these guys, you know, they weren't the top of the top players when they came into the league. What are your thoughts on that?
Okay. My thoughts are I don't like super teams as far as guys – I love guys playing with the guys they want to play with. So if today, if I could play with Juwan, actually, I went to play with Juwan in D.C. So I got to be careful because I went to go play with my friends.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I don't want guys chasing validity that they don't need.
Okay.
So for instance, let's just say LeBron.
Yeah.
I think this year he can recruit a bunch of great guys and still win in Cleveland. I don't know necessarily if 10 guys have to go to L.A. But to your point in about Golden State, anytime you draft players, you can't call that a super team out the gate.
Yeah.
When you drafted Curry, they didn't know he was going to be this great. One of the best point guards to ever play the game already. They didn't know that. Or Thompson, one of the best shooters ever. Because in college, they only showed flashes of it. I think they truly became a super team when Kevin Durant went there.
Okay.
And I think it's Kevin Durant's right to go there and to play there and to be that kind of closer for them. They play the best basketball that there is. What do I mean by that? They don't play this one-on-one type ball unless they have to. The ball moves. Everybody gets each other involved. And, I mean, they have the livest practices. They have a DJ, live DJ at their practice.
Yeah, but that's what I'm trying to tell you.
I was like, you wasn't at the practice.
I'm just saying, Mel.
No, they have a great culture. And in order to me to be a super team, you have to have a great locker room with great cats. Like, I keep saying this, and Day-Day, I don't know, I hope he don't take it personal, but to have a player like Draymond Green, who maybe on other teams, people wouldn't respect as much. They may say, oh, he can't do this, he can't do – well, on Golden State, he does everything. I don't know if Golden State would have won one championship without him. To me, he was the MVP on that team that allowed Curry to be the MVP for the world because he allowed Curry to do his thing. You got to have a selfless guy on your team like that.
Yeah.
A guy willing to be a bad guy, a guy willing to get technicals and all that so the nice guys can stay nice, you know, and he gets on Durant. So you need that on the super team. You can't buy the heart of Draymond Green. They would not win without him. How about Clay? Klay is one of the best players in the world, and he's probably the most underrated player in the world because we don't say the Splash Brothers no more. We say Durant and Curry.
Yes.
But he just stays in his pocket. He's a humble dude, says, you know what, just give me my money. I'm blessed. And so you got to have perfect egos. You got to have a perfect locker room to be a super team that's done something. Because you remember the Lakers? They had a super team. Gary Payton, Karl Malone. Yeah. And they lost.
Yeah.
They were terrible. Yeah. So you got to really have that locker room in order to be a super team too.
Thank you, Chris Webber. I appreciate
it. Did I just help you out?
Yeah, yes, oh, man. Okay. I argue with this every single day. The rumblings of LeBron and Paul George possibly going to the Lakers. What are your thoughts on that? And is this just rumor, you know, talk in the air, or is this a possibility?
I think it's a possibility, but I hope LeBron stays in Cleveland. I don't think he needs to chase a ring. If LeBron retired today, his legacy is cemented.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's the time of social media, and everybody has an opinion, including myself, but my opinion is he should stay there and just keep doing it. Hmm. You know, going to L.A., you might not get out the second round.
This is true.
You know what I mean? You could lose to Golden State or Houston. You want that problem? You could lose to Denver, who's really good. And in the East, he already has his team. We know who it is. It's his culture. It's his foundation. Mm-hmm. Come join him. I know that last year was tough. 20 different players. But he made the finals.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like
he made the finals.
That's incredible. You know, in this day of all, if you don't win, that's stupid. This dude made the finals with different teammates and never had a Hall of Fame coach and took all his coaches to the finals for the first time. We only know Eric Spoelstra because of him. So, you know, I hope that he stays and recruits. And just let me just say this about LeBron. And the good thing is I don't know these cats.
Yeah.
So
You don't know LeBron?
I don't know LeBron. I don't know if I ever had a conversation with him because I try to keep it. I try to keep, you know, professional respect. So I'm a fan.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm a critic. So I want to – but within saying all that, I just saw Jesse Jackson down the hall, and I'm a big – you know, Jim Brown's a mentor. Kareem's a mentor of mine. Bill Russell's a mentor. And I've said this to them. I don't know if anyone has had the resources as an athlete to do what LeBron has done off the court.
Uh-huh.
He's one of the greatest men. And, again, I don't know him. He's one of the greatest men to me. Off the court, this dude gave 1,000 scholarships away.
Wow.
You know what
put
I mean?
Put that in perspective.
Yeah. How much money is that? This kid wants to get people out of Akron like him and give them opportunity and access. Like, the stuff he does, the fact that he goes on the court with an I Can't Breathe shirt. You know, we don't have to shout out to friends that are football players, but we don't have that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so the fact that he constantly says these things and put it on the line when other people can shy away from it. I admire what the kid did, and I just, you know, I think maybe he should stay in Cleveland and keep it going. And if he wants to go to L.A. because Magic's a great recruiter, hey, go do your thing. But I don't think it would hurt him staying in Cleveland.
If you were playing in this day and age, when you look at what's happening with Eric Reed and Colin Kaepernick and their fight to bring, you know, awareness to police brutality and equality and fairness in our judicial system and all, you know, all the factors why they actually took a knee.
Yes.
It had nothing to do with their patriotism and the flag.
No.
Can you cross, like, pollinate that messaging to NBA? Would you take a knee if you were, you know, as an NBA player? And should NBA players join that movement?
So, first of all, shout out to Colin Kaepernick and those guys that did take a knee. That was their way to speak. But the NBA, we don't have to do that, bro. Just ask a guy what they think. Like, you know, they wore I Can't Breathe shirts.
Yeah.
I mean, think about that. Kneel during the anthem or wear I Can't Breathe shirts so a million people can see it and go, wait, why are they talking? I can't breathe. What, is that a rap song? No, it's because this guy passed away. It's because – so it's not like we need to take a knee. It's the NBA was built on – guys like Bill Russell speaking up. I don't know if you really go into history of him retiring and talking about the racism in Boston and not getting his jersey retired. He got his jersey retired with 4 people in the arena because he was like, I'm not giving them that.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's not cool for basketball to talk about or things like that, but you look at the official signing when you had Muhammad Ali saying he wasn't going to go to war. It was Bill Russell right there with him. It was Kareem. Those guys were the pillars.
Jim Brown.
They always spoke up. And so basketball has been on speaking your mind. This is our culture.
Yeah.
And so we don't let owners, we don't let anybody think they got a little bit of money. You can't change that because you're going to lose the business of basketball, and they don't want to do that. And shout out to David Stern, Adam Silver, that balances that relationship quick. But no, we don't need to take any. This guy's speaking up every game. This guy's at rallies and talking. So to each his own, and everybody do it their way. But I think the NBA has been really great at guys with a lot on the line. You know, Dwayne Wade, Chris Paul, those guys speaking up and saying, you know, it's unfair.
We're starting to see other NFL players now, star players, that are threatening to not play in the season if these two guys don't get jobs, and they're going to try to get 25% of other players in the whole league. And so they understand their value and how they can use that power to affect change. We got Chris Webber here. I want to continue this conversation, man. What y'all don't know is, Chris, you put out an album, right?
Oh, man. Like, that's 20 years ago, man.
Yeah, but you put out an album, dog.
Yeah, I made some beats for Nas. Let's get to that. That's better than my album.
Nah. We'll get to the Blunt Ashes. We're going to get to that. You know, but you had a song on your album, Too Much Drama.
Oh, Lord, Gangsta. What up, Corrupt?
But Corrupt feature Corrupt. It's Chris Webber right here. It's called Gangsta. 20 years ago, he was a gangster. Now look at him. 888-742-3345. Sway in the Morning. New film, Uncle Drew, is coming out this Friday, the 29th. Got a soundtrack that's available now featuring ASAP Ferg, G-Eazy, French Montana, Remy Ma. Kyrie Irving is featured in it. Shaquille O'Neal is in it. Lil Rel Howery is in it. Reggie Miller's in it. Nate Robinson's in it. Yeah. Lisa Leslie's in it. Erica Ash, J.B. Smooth, Mike Epps, Tiffany Haddish, Nick Kroll, Aaron Gordon. And our guest today, ladies and gentlemen, the one and only Chris Webber.
Yo.
Thanks for having me.
Wait a minute now. What's going on?
I used everything I got on this tournament.
You lost our superstar to another coach.
What's that smell? Is that a grudge?
This is the perfect opportunity for dads to meet Uncle Drew, the greatest blacktop player I've ever seen in my life.
Come on now. Gotta get the boys.
Drew's putting the squad back together.
Oh, time out.
Pass the ball, Kobe.
Come on, Drew, you told me these dudes can play. And this dude, he's a karate man.
Hey,
he's meditating right now. This guy right here can't even see.
Swish!
How's that geriatric team of yours? You got them all individual life alert bracelets?
So we gon' ball.
We gon' ball.
Chris plays Preacher in this upcoming film, man. The trailers look hilarious, man. Who's Preacher, man?
Preacher, he's a guy that, you know, has anger management issues. Think about Charles Oakley or somebody like that when they're 90 years old, you know, okay. 85 years old and married to Lisa Leslie and Betty Lou in the movie. And she just doesn't want me to go back to that old life. You know, she's trying to keep me out them streets, them basketball streets. And it's a lot of fun. I think it's like Blues Brothers meets Space Jam or something like that. I think the kids are going to love it. It was a lot of fun. And shout out to all the actors and actresses that do this for a living that really helped us step our game up. I saw the movie last night, man. I can honestly say when I read the script, or before I got the script, I was like, I don't want to do this. It's going to be magnificently corny or something like that.
Yeah.
But it was, I think the kids going to love it, man. It's a good movie.
All right, and what is it about?
It's about Uncle Drew getting his team back together. Uncle Drew is a basketball player, a 75-year-old old man that wants kids to play the right way.
Okay.
And he's in the parks, and he just wants to show kids how to play the right way. Little Rel has a team. His team leaves him. He wants to play in the Harlem Rucker. And Uncle Drew says, listen, I'll do it, but, you know, you got to let me pick my squad. And so he come get the old heads, and we got to go show the people what time it is.
That sounds hilarious, right?
Chris, real quick, I had a question, because I think it's funny that you play somebody named Preach. Yeah. I always tell Sway every time your name come up while we rooting for you. I was like, you know, every conversation I've ever had with Chris has always been like spiritual and positive. Do you mind sharing a little bit about your spirituality in your life? Because I think it's dope when I see players praying and supporting each other, and you walked in today saying thank God. Do you mind sharing a little bit of that and why that's so important for you?
Yeah, well, first of all, Heather, thank you for, you know, the conversation that we used to have when I was in D.C. and other places. I mean, you were positive as well, and I remember texting you with some, I won't say low moments, but you have low moments all the time. And so that energy you gave me, you know, is positive. And so, man, I just think life happens. I was raised to know that there is a bigger entity than myself, that, you know, we're not the kings of the universe and that we're blessed. So our success comes from God and from great people that help motivate us and cultivate us. And, you know, my whole thing is, how do you keep a balance? You know, I was, man, Wow, my father, I don't even, you know, didn't graduate middle school. He actually grew up on a, you know, I'm writing a book right now, so it's all in my head, but he grew up on a plantation, you know, like mm-hmm. a lot of people talk about the injustices, but my father lived it, like picking cotton in Mississippi with a guy over you telling you to do this. And, you know, my mother was different. She was from Detroit, education. And so I had both humble people, but my father was a hard worker, nothing that was ever given to him. So if I would mm-hmm. complain, he's like, what you talking about, boy? This ain't nothing. And then mm-hmm. the same time, my mother's like, no, you can do more. I understand. And I had that balance, and I saw how God's grace hit my family. I saw how I took my father out. I helped my mother and working in schools, kids getting shot, and she's at the school and didn't get shot. Like, how does this stuff happen? And so from calling the time out at Michigan, the lowest point, you come home, and your mom's like, baby, look, I got a license plate. It says time out with the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. You're going to change some kids' lives. And then seeing we started scholarships then, and, you know, you don't even think about time out no more, but probably 100 kids went to college because of that. Not because of that, but in the name of that. So it's just how do you get through tough times? How do you celebrate great times without getting over your head? How do you walk through hell and walk through those tough times without getting too down? And he's, you know, God has just been a balance, you know what I mean? When friends and people leave you, whenever what happened, you know, he's there. And so I'm not perfect. I have to work on my walk every day, but definitely I thank the Lord for all he's done for me.
Chris Webber, man, I like that. Turned a negative into a positive. No, I'm not. And Mike, you guys went to. Did you go to Michigan, Mike?
Yeah. So that's what I'm gonna say, man.
Go blue,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, man. And speaking of, your legacy is what inspired people to go to college. I'm originally from Lansing, Michigan, and so I'm younger than you. But growing up, I watched you on the television.
He needed to say that.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I get it. Expert fisherman on my right and young boy on my left. Okay. All right.
Yeah. I was like, in context of how much you inspired me and really brought Michigan to the forefront, and to see the way you guys revolutionized basketball in the Fab Five, man, we looked up to you guys, and I couldn't wait to become a Michigan man to continue that legacy that the 5-5 left, and to be a part of that Michigan man experience, man. So just salute to you for that, and I thank you for being you and your greatness and really redefining what it means to be a Michigan man. But with that being said, though, Chris, you know, we know, speaking of movies and documentaries, we know about the Fab Five doc,
yeah,
right? And we know that you didn't participate,
yeah,
but we knew that there was some conversation that you were going to produce your own documentary, tell your own story,
right?
And I'm just curious, where are we with that in the process now, in particular the way we're talking about the NCAA and whether an athlete should be paid as students?
But thank you first of all for the inspiring part about Michigan. That's really what we wanted to do, because we were all from a neighborhood like you, and you know, others inspired us to kind of go there. And shout out to Jasmine Guy, because she inspired me to want to go to college, be like Dwayne Wayne, yeah, you know, in the show and all that. No, yeah. But I wasn't part of the Fab Five doc because I got a call when basically it was over. I was going to be an afterthought. And I'm like, you can't, you know, I'm not all that, but you damn sure ain't going to make me an afterthought in the documentary and tell my story for me. And so, you know, the Fab Five in Michigan, that was a part of my life, a very important part, a wonderful part. I made lifelong friends, but, you know, that was just one part of my life. So the documentary, hopefully, we're filming now, hopefully it'll be done by August. I'm writing a book. Hopefully it'll be done in August and come up this year. But I want to, I'm very excited that Coach Harbaugh called me. He had been calling me probably the last 3 or 4 years asking if I would come back to the game. And I was like, Coach, it's just not time. I'll either be a distraction. I need to heal from this. You know, I've been accused of things we got to talk about in an open forum. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't personal against him, the basketball coach, or anything. It was just like, this is above y'all. This is bigger. And so being banned from the school and going through all that, it was it really pissed me off. And so it was like, wait a minute, you know, tell your story. And so I'm glad I get a chance to tell my story. And hopefully it'll be inspirational. Hopefully, you'll see what I've been going through in those years. But I really want to give people in Michigan and other people my story. I haven't help with my silence. And my silence makes you complicit. You know, it makes you like, oh, yeah, whatever he says. And it's been hard being silent and letting everybody talk and speaking for you. That's been so hard. And so hopefully now I get to come out, you know, with my story and have some fun with it.
But with that being said, speaking of division within the Michigan community, we can't talk about your legacy without talking about Jalen Rose.
Right.
And so we're all just curious, will there ever be a time when you two will have a conversation? And where does your relationship stand with Jalen Rose now?
We don't really have a relationship. You know, I've never talked about anything with the Fab Five or anything. And so when he broke that code, you know, to what I feel further his career, that hurt me as a man.
Yeah.
You know, because they don't love us.
Yeah.
Mm. That's how we built the Fab Five. They don't love us.
Mm-hmm.
So to give them what they want and become one of them now when you can always be yourself and hold your integrity. That really hurt me. Mm-hmm. And so we're brothers, and so I love him, mm-hmm. you know. But he was on some bullshit. Mm-hmm. And that's how that is. And, you know, I'm the oldest of five kids. And so my mom taught me, like, if we're in the street, me and my other brother are fighting, if anybody else come and try to break it up, beat them up and get back to fighting because you're family. And okay. that's the way I feel with him. So I feel like I can, you know, say what I have to say, but if anybody else says it, we're going to have a problem.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, and yeah. so hopefully that love will be there. But as far as the fellas that talk Juwan all the time, Ray all the time, and it's cool, but, you know, no, not necessarily with Jalen. You know, to troll me and talk about time out 25 years later on the show and to break it down and all that, you know, it's just kind of corny, man. Like every week, and then, you know, even the other day, you know, why didn't he go back to basketball? Like, dude, like the one has some integrity and just wait. Don't talk about us. Don't let the producers gas you up. Yeah. Like this is bigger than that. So hopefully we will have a talk. But in the meantime, yeah, we just haven't. And whenever that time is, but right now I'm very glad to be going back to Michigan.
Chris Webber, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey, man, and then. You know, I saw Magic and Isaiah sit down and talk, so I could you guys could come up here and talk right here on Sway in the Morning. If you ever walk
and
in.
When we do, it'll be a glorious thing because you know we were running brothers. So you know, I definitely expect all the positivity to happen, and you know, I'm asking for forgiveness from friends and family for things that I've done, and you know, right now God's been working on me with forgiving. So you know what I mean. So. Just the truth of what I said, but I'm not on no pedestal saying this or that. We're going to have those conversations, hopefully, but this is the beginning of a process coming back to Michigan, and that's what's cool, man.
All right, Tracy G, you want to ask one final question?
Yeah, real quick, Chris. I just want to know your thoughts. Like, I feel like hip-hop and basketball have always been so highly correlated. You know, even Jay will talk about walk like a ball player, but it never feels like hip-hop football, hip-hop baseball. What is it about basketball that you think really appeals to hip-hop?
That's a great question. I don't know. Is it because of the arena? You know, we have a little more, you know, I used to pick out the songs before basketball games.
Oh, what?
Oh, yeah, in Sacramento. So they was like, what is this? You know what I mean? We'd be playing from E-40 to the clean version of Short to Nas to KRS-O.
You name an Oakland artist, Heather. I just want to let you know.
You don't know about no Drew Down.
Hip of the year?
You know, everybody in my neighborhood wanted to be a hooper or a rapper.
Right.
You know what I mean? I'm much older than you, so I remember when Run DMC came out and they were beatboxing, and my boy, we were playing basketball, and he came out. He was like, hit it, run, it's beatboxing on this. Can you believe it? It's just a natural. We admire the swag of the rappers. They admire ours. We have close friendships. I think their music inspires us. When you talk about don't listen to what people say, be your own man, you know, that's all hooper. You take that to you. And I was telling Nas one time, like, he didn't get, he got it that he's a great artist, but he didn't get that he gave soul and spirit to the brothers that were hooping. Like, when you go through it, you would pop in his tape and listen to what he was talking about, or Jay or something like that. And so, you know, I think, you know, they were like our psychologists back then. They were like the friends back then. They were inspiring. And so I remember in Michigan, we got dogged and we got called thugs because the first day we caught our hair bald, we beat, like, Michigan State or somebody. And I remember jumping on the table and Hip Hop Array, and we had 20,000 people going, hey, ho. And I remember being like, this must be what we're going to feel like on the stage. Yeah. You know, everybody following us. So I don't know how it's like that, but that relationship with basketball and hip hop, hopefully it never changes because, you know, we love hip hop.
Yeah.
Chris Webber is here. I'm going to take one call. Chaos is in North Carolina.
Chaos,
go ahead, Chaos.
Is popping.
Hey.
Good morning, Sway. Good morning, Heather B. Hey. Chris Webber and everybody else.
What's up, bro?
Man, But Chris, man, I didn't know that you did the pro. I seen the name on the producer that helped produce. It said C. Webber. I didn't know it was you for Blunt Ashes with Nas, man. But I love that track, man, and I even love it more knowing that you had some input in it, man. And your album, I liked it. That Ride With Me, and the track that you did with Red, man.
Wow, I did not expect this today. Thank you. That was nothing to do. Shout out to Red, man.
Yeah, Ride With Me.
Wow.
All I got, all these different songs. We used to play it on the Wake Up Show, man. Come on, man.
Yeah,
you know you got that warrior pride in you.
No doubt.
You know, man, I really appreciate you. Uncle Drew's in theaters this Friday, June 29th. I'm happy for you. I'm proud of you. Absolutely. I'm inspired by you.
Thank you.
You family, man.
Thank you. No doubt. You family. Family, so thank you, though. Thank you. Thank you, Heather B. Love you.
And then Erica said I could come back over.
Oh, yeah. Right, yeah. I mean, it's her house now. Yeah. She ain't going to let you clean the fish in the house, though. She make us do it outside.
Okay, now. That's okay, because okay. I cut them, cook them, clean them, consume them, and shit them out. You know, so I do all of it. I'm sorry, I'm not like that. All right, cool. Chris Webber, man, thank you again, brother. Yeah,
thank you, guys.
All right, and since he brought it up, man, let's hear that Blunt Ashes by Nas, produced by Chris Webber. Black. We'll be right back.